Well, he's a best-selling author of A Century of Restaurants, stories and recipes from 100 of America's most historic and successful restaurants. And he is on TV as well on a great show called Barbecue America. And I am so happy to have on Rick Brown. Hey, Rick.
How are you?
I am good. I love this whole concept.
Thank you very much. It's gotten quite a good reception around the country. I just did a taping this morning. I'm in Washington, D.C. I just did a taping on CNN that they're going to run next week, the day before Thanksgiving. I was in the only restaurant in Washington, D.C. that's in the book that's 100 years old.
Well, that's so appropriate. I love this. I love this. And like you mentioned, Thanksgiving, it's right around the corner. Your book is perfectly filled with recipes and historical information. Tell us what led you to write A Century of Restaurants, stories and recipes from 100 of America's most historic and successful restaurants. I want to get that whole title in there.
Long title. Well, I was visiting Michigan, where I grew up, and I was eating dinner at a restaurant in Marshall, Michigan that I had gone to with my parents when I was younger. And the waiter happened to mention that they were 100 years old, and I never realized this. And when I got back home to Washington, I did some research and thought, well, you know, this might make a good article if I could find 25 or 30 of these restaurants that are 100 years old in the U.S. It would be a fun article. And then as I researched, I found there were over 250.
That's amazing.
It went from an article to a book, but even for a book, 250 is unmanageable. So I decided to do 100 distributed to as many states as possible. And even then, it turned out to be a 400-page book, but it's just so loaded with American history. It's literally a history of America as seen through its restaurants.
Well, I'm a totally visual person, and I must say the photography in your book is totally amazing. How important is it to you to show your pictures along with the words you're expressing to your readers? Because I think it's fabulous.
Well, thank you very much for the compliment. I did all the photography. I have published 15 barbecue cookbooks, and in all of them, I've always supplied all the photography. So it's very important because otherwise, it's a boring sort of historical book that people would look at, and maybe some would be interested in. But I like to take the viewers into each restaurant because I'm the one that got to go to all these places around the country. They didn't. And unfortunately, I can't offer them a taste of the food, but I sure can offer them some visuals of what the trip was like.
Wow. Well, I think it's so cool. I think that you could take people on adventures in person, too. I mean, I think that would be such a cool trip, you know, to actually go and hit some of the restaurants with you.
Well, we're trying to actually, a public television station is interested in being my presenting station and taking it to PBS nationwide. But at the same time, I'm looking at one of the cable networks because I think I could do better with it and reach a broader amount of people on a cable network because
sure.
What I would do would be visit a restaurant per program. And, I mean, there's some fascinating places, fascinating stories out there.
I could only imagine.
Give people a real idea of American culinary history, how it's represented through these wonderful restaurants.
Well, if you're just joining me, I am visiting with author Rick Brown, who's got a fabulous new book out, and it's called A Century of Restaurants, and it's stories and recipes from over 100 of America's most historic and successful restaurants. Now, there's so many stories, I'm sure, but let's talk about the restaurant in Denver that was visited by a tribal war party of 30 Blackfeet Indians in 1938, full war paint, battle dress. They rode up on horseback with a great ceremony, delivered a historic gift to the owner. I mean, tell my listeners about this.
Well, in Denver, there's a restaurant called the Buckhorn Exchange. And these days, it has more stuffed animal of all sizes and descriptions than any other restaurant in the world. I mean, you're literally eating inside a zoo, which may bother some people from setup.
Only if they're a vegetarian, right?
That's right. If you're vegetarian, do not walk into
Don't go
restaurant.
There.
You'll have a stroke. But early on in its history, the owner was Henry Zeitz. And he had been a scout for Buffalo Bill since he was 10 years old.
That's so
and
cool.
And later on, he worked with Buffalo Bill and the and Sitting Bull and the rest of the Indians that were in the Buffalo Bill Wild West show. And they called him Shorty. And later on in life, when he ran the restaurant, one day this group of Indians rode up to the restaurant in full battle dress on their war ponies, and they said, "We're Shorty," and it came out. And the Indian, the chief that was with the party, was related to Chief Red Bull.
Oh, wow.
Which was, I'm sorry, Chief Sitting Bull.
And either one. They're big.
Yeah. Red Bull was his son. He got off his horse and walked over to Shorty and handed him this buckskin wrapped package. And Shorty didn't know what it was, and he opened it, and it was the sword from General Custer.
My goodness. That's what, serious.
I mean, and I asked the owner, I said, "Do you guys still have it?" "Well, it's still in their family. They do not display it at the restaurant." That would be worth $1 million.
Oh,
I
my
mean,
gosh.
The sword of General Custer.
That is,
but they gave it to him as a gift.
That's totally special. That is amazing.
Yeah,
there's
so many special stories at these restaurants. It's just phenomenal, all the stuff that I was lucky enough to uncover.
Well, it took you 3 years to do all the research on these 100-plus-year-old inns, taverns, and restaurants, right?
Yes. I traveled around. I actually traveled more than 46,000 miles around the U.S.
How did you get there? How did you get there? Planes, trains, and automobiles?
Well, planes and automobiles. I would fly, let's say, to Atlanta. Then I'd get in a rental car, and I'd drive to 6 or 7 surrounding states. The last trip I made, though, I started out in Washington, and I drove all the way across the country to Michigan, then all the way back down through Texas and Colorado and back to the state of Washington where I live. It was 8,800 miles. I did that in 18 days. And
wow.
And visited the restaurants all along the way, which was total insanity.
Totally.
but got some great stories out of it, including the buckhorn.
Listen, hey, if you're just joining me, I am visiting with author Rick Brown, who did us the favor of traveling thousands of miles across the country to give us 100 of America's most historic and successful restaurants. Okay, so listen to me, Rick. You only got one choice. You can only go back to one restaurant. Just one.
Mean. You're so
just
mean.
One. Now, off the
you're
top,
so
I know, but I know you got one. You got one passionate restaurant. You got to make up your mind. You got like now. What is it?
Commander's Palace.
See?
In New Orleans.
I know it.
You do?
Yes. Yes. Our family goes to New Orleans. Commander's Palace. So tell everybody about Commander's Palace.
Commander's Palace is pretty unique. First of all, it's across from one of the most historic graveyards in America, which makes it kind of cool, especially at Halloween.
Sure.
Half of New Orleans is there. In the old days, it used to be a place, at least the upstairs, where gentlemen were entertained by ladies, and I don't mean playing the banjo.
Are you talking about ladies of the working kind?
They were working, yes.
They were making a living.
Working.
Okay.
Yeah, I wouldn't say what they were working at, but they were working.
So it was a brothel, is what we're saying?
It was a brothel for a while.
Okay.
As I say, it's across from the Lafayette Cemetery, which is the most famous graveyard in New Orleans.
Yes.
It is owned by the Brennan family. They bought it in 1974, and it is just a fantastic restaurant. I mean, it is some of the best food I had in the entire trip. But I have to tell you, I've been asked before for this, and I always weaseled out of it by saying I have three.
Okay. Tell us the other two.
The second two are the Old Ebbitt Grill in Washington, D.C.
Oh, I don't know that.
In fact, I just was there today, and I'm going there for dinner. I just taped the CNN segment about the book at the restaurant. And the other one is King's Chop House in New York City.
Oh, I don't know that. King's Chop House?
Yeah, King's, K-E-E-N-S.
K-E-E-N-S.
And what's unique about it is that they have 50,000 clay pipes on the ceiling in all the rooms of the restaurant.
Oh, my
gosh. Because in the old days, gentlemen would come and they'd ask the pipe warden to find their pipe. They gave him a number. He would go locate their clay pipe, bring it to them, and they'd smoke their pipe at the restaurant. Because these pipes were made from clay, they were very delicate, so you really couldn't carry them around. So they, like, sort of like a library, they left them at the restaurant. When they came in, they got to smoke their clay pipe.
Wow.
It's also the site of probably the biggest, well, not probably, the biggest hunk of lamb roast I've ever had in my life. It's a double mutton chop, and it must weigh about 2.5 pounds. It is absolutely incredible.
Okay.
So those three restaurants, to me, are the ultimate.
All right, so I'm a hamburger girl, Rick. Where is the best hamburger in the United States? Where do I have to go to get the best burger?
Well, I'm gonna say right off that these aren't the best two burgers in the United States, but they're by far the two oldest burgers in the United States.
Okay.
One is in Coeur d'Alene, Idaho.
Okay.
Hudson's Hamburgers. And it's very plain. I mean, it's shocking how plainly these are cooked with salt and pepper on an open grill.
But is it good, Rick? Is it mouth-watering good, or is it just old?
It's mouth-watering good, and there's a line out the door. There's only 18 seats to the restaurant. I've never been there without 50 to 60 people in line out the door waiting for it. And the other one, and I was just at this place a couple weeks ago, was Louie's Lunch in New Haven, Connecticut.
Oh.
And the unique thing about those burgers is they are using the same barbecue grills, broilers, that they used when they opened in the 1800s. The exact same one. Nothing has changed. These things are still pumping out the gas, and it's a vertical broiler. The hamburgers are put in this sort of device, and they're stuck in this broiler, and the flame comes from both sides.
Wow.
And like Hudson's Hamburgers in Coeur d'Alene, these are all made to order. And you do not ask for condiments on these places.
Oh, wow.
At Louie's Lunch, you get a sauce that they have and a tomato, slice of tomato, slice of onion. That's it. No mustard, no
ketchup. So you got to smuggle in the condiments, right?
You throw them away. They are not. In fact, you ask for them, they'll ask you to leave.
Oh, my gosh.
Because it's just him. And they serve on bread. Because the story goes that a salesman came in the 1800s, was in a hurry, wanted some chopped steak, but couldn't eat it there. He says, can you find some way to get me to take it with me? So I guess the original owner put two slices of bread, toasted them, put the hamburger in the middle of it, and served it up. And that's the way they're served today.
And so that is the first hamburger.
That's right.
I love that. All right, now listen to me, Rick. Thanksgiving is just around the corner, and you are the barbecue grill master. Is there a way to grill a turkey?
Absolutely. There's several ways. I'm going to give you a website. It's my barbecue, www.barbecueamerica.com, and a barbecue is spelled with a C, B-A-R-B-E-C-U-E, barbecueamerica.com. There's several recipes. One of them is a North Carolina-style turkey where you split the turkey in half, you wrap it in bacon, and you cook it right on the grill.
Oh, my gosh.
And then you serve it with a North Carolina-style vinegar, sugar, and red pepper sauce, and I tell you what, it is awesome.
That sounds pretty darn good.
Yeah. Actually, it's a barbecue grill, to me, is nothing more than an oven that you take outside.
That's true.
I've cooked soufflés, flans, cakes, pies, everything on a barbecue grill. You just have to use it appropriately. But all it is a stove that you happen to have on your back deck.
So is there a restaurant out of these 100 restaurants that could possibly be serving Thanksgiving meal for those that maybe don't want to cook and want to go visit some historic restaurant as part of their family trip?
I would bet that all of them.
Wow.
I know Commander's Palace has a Thanksgiving dinner. I know the Old Ebbitt Grill does. I would feel fairly comfortable in saying first of all, they've been in business between 100 and 300 years, so they don't miss any tricks.
They know it all.
They know what to do, and they're going to be sure and have a special Thanksgiving menu. Even some of the smaller ones, they're going to have something special because, you know, it's one of the if there's one holiday that's associated with eating, even more than Christmas, It's Thanksgiving.
That's for sure. Oh, my gosh. So Rick. Go ahead.
No, I was just going to say, this ain't their first rodeo. So they're going to have something ready.
Well, Rick, I got to tell you, this book is exciting to me. I think it's a great read for anybody who either wants to cook and loves food and wants to understand restaurants, get a history lesson. And thanks for doing all the traveling for us and taking all the hard work out of it.
Well, you're welcome. It was a dream that I had for a long time. I'm totally thrilled with the results. I just want people to, well, not only buy the book and read it, but to preserve these historic restaurants, because if we don't preserve them, they're going to disappear, and we're going to lose our culinary heritage,
right.
And we're going to be a nation of nothing but fast food restaurants, and that would be tragic.
Well, we don't want that to happen. So, Rick, where can we find your book?
You can find it online at any of the online bookstores. You can find it at the remaining bookstores that actually have brick-and-mortar places.
Cool.
You can also find it on my website, which is centuryofrestaurants.com. I have a link to amazon.com there.
Perfect.
They're all over the country. If you can get on your computer, you can buy one, or if there's a bookstore in your town, you'll be able to pick it up. I think it makes a great Christmas gift because it's for everybody, foodies and people who like
I agree.
People who like traveling.
I agree.
But again, my whole purpose is to please, please, please people, patronize these historic restaurants, keep them alive because they're part of America.
Yes, they are. And Rick, thank you so much for bringing this book to us. And go buy this book. I tell you, it's got so much fun history in it. And it's called A Century of Restaurants, Stories and Recipes from 100 of America's Most Historic and Successful Restaurants. Rick, thank you so much for joining us today. And I hope you come back next time you write another book.
Okay, I will do that, I promise. And thanks for having me on. And you have a great weekend. And if I don't talk to you ahead of time, Happy Thanksgiving, but make sure you go out to a restaurant and eat it.
All right. Thanks so much, Rick.
Thank you. Bye-bye.
Bye-bye. Up next, Jason Stratham has a new movie coming out, and Tara Hitchcock is going to tell us all about it right here on The Moll Anderson Show.